is the Holy Spirit play. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
If we will, let's look real quick. We don't always do this. I probably should do it more often, and I need to start doing it more often. And you know, Brother Buddy Harrison said one time, he said, always give people faith to give. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And Malachi 3, verse 8 says, will a man rob God? Yet ye've robbed me. But you say, wherein have we robbed thee? And the answer is in tithes and offerings. You're cursed with a curse, for you've robbed me, even this whole nation. Now listen, how do you get out from under the curse? Bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse, and prove me now herewith, or into the storehouse, there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I'll not open unto you the windows of heaven, and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes. He shall not destroy the fruits of your ground, neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts, and all nations shall call you blessed, for you shall be a delightsome land, saith the Lord of hosts. Amen. God says if you bring the tithe, he'll open up heaven's windows. And actually, the Bible, King James says, pour out a blessing. The Hebrew says, empty out on you a blessing. That sounds like something in the New Testament, doesn't it? How shall he who spared not his own son not also with him freely give us all things? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Father, we thank you for the tithe. We thank you for the offering. Thank you for the people being blessed. We thank you that you open up heaven's windows and pour out blessings on them they don't have room enough to receive. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, ushers, go ahead and receive that. While they're receiving that, I'm going to dive into some water here. Some icy water. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Once they're done. All right, children's church, preschool, and youth. Youth is having breakfast this morning. I saw that. I saw some fruit and some stuff to drink. You know, it's like a glory to God. Amen, 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 amen. Come on out on Wednesday nights. Get blessed. If you haven't been here for the last couple of months on Wednesday nights, go back. You need to go back and look at it. You can see it on the Facebook page, on the YouTube channel, on the website. There's all kinds of ways to get it. And we believe we worked out our problems with our Facebook live stream. We found that we were really actually just having a problem with an iPad connection for some reason. And because, you know, it was saying it wasn't getting signal. And I turn around and look, and there's the tower. Now, how can you not be getting signal? There's the tower. I mean, I'm getting zapped right now. There's all kind of conversations going through me. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. I mean, you could kind of go, bzzz. You put an antenna up, you'd be like a Gilligan's Island episode. All right. Well, we're glad you're here. We're glad you're part of the family of God. And we're going to begin ministering this morning on something we've been on, you know, fulfilling your destiny, your purpose, and, you know, being, you know, steward of the word, listening to the Holy Ghost. But we're going to move into this. We're going to talk about the blessing of Abraham. Everybody say the blessing of Abraham. Now, one of the misnomers, I believe, in the church today is there is an attempt, and I believe a genuine attempt, for people to be humble before God and not be ingracious, not to be self-serving, and et cetera, et cetera. And in doing so, we often cheat ourselves out of what God said he wanted to do for us. Okay? We you know, Lord, you don't have to do that. I can handle this. And, you know, as you said Wednesday night, a lot of people who come to God go, well, you know, I don't need for you to do this for me. I don't need for you to do that for me. But God's already said he wants to do it for us. And really, it's more arrogant. Really, if you kind of look at it from one perspective, it begins to look more like arrogance than it does humility. Because you're saying, I can do it without you. Hello. Now, I can, you know, Lord, if you can just get me $50, I can get the other 50 myself. Did you know the Bible says he blesses us exceedingly abundantly above all we can ask or even think? Hello? Now, It'd be different if God came to us and we tried to start crowbarring God into doing stuff for us that he didn't ever say he wanted to do. But the fact of the matter is, God wants you blessed. Now, don't get me wrong. Don't go out here, and turn me off right. Don't turn me off right now. You know, I'm one of them name it, claim it, frame it preachers. I'm not a name it, claim it, frame it preacher. God already named it, and God framed it and gave it to me. He just told me to receive it. In the same way, if you say that, then salvation is a name it, claim it, frame it, act on your part. God provided healing. God provided prosperity. God provided blessing in the same way he provided being born again. Hello. As a matter of fact, the Hebrew and the Greek words for salvation and save include those meanings behind them. Hallelujah. So, we don't need to be trying to act, humble. I'm so humble that, I would never want to come to God and ask him to heal me. That would be, demanding too much. Jesus paid the price for it. It was so important to God you be healed. He put our sicknesses on Jesus when he put our sins on Jesus. Not only our sin nature. Hallelujah. So we want to talk about, let's go to Galatians, the third chapter, if you will. Now this week, somebody's going to send me a text message before Sunday. It says backdrop, aren't you? Aren't you? All right, two of you said, uh-huh. All right. Galatians chapter 3, if you'll turn there with me, please. It says here in Galatians chapter 3, starting in verse 13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Well, that was for the Jews. They were under the law. Okay, verse 14. That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles. See, we are too quick to have little narratives that discount our ability to get what the Word of God says we can have. Because somebody's come up with all kinds of answers as to why you can't have it. One, all the gifts of the Spirit passed away the day the last apostle died. You ever heard that one? I've heard that one. Well, you know what, folks? There are only 12 apostles of the Lamb. But there are other apostles, and there'll never be another class of apostles like the 12 apostles of the Lamb, those that ate with Jesus, sat with him, sat at dinner with him, traveled with him. They're the only ones that will ever be that. But they're still apostles. Paul was an apostle, and he never sat with Jesus. Are you here? He's not an apostle of the Lamb. He's an apostle. There are others in the Bible that are apostles. And so, they come along, the day of the last, John was on the island, he died, and everything just stopped. I get amazed at how people can come up with this stuff. I just do. Where did you come up with that one at in the first place? It was an explanation of why they couldn't get things to happen. Okay? No, Jesus said, the Word says, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. The Bible says here in Galatians, I do believe that's a New Testament book, don't you? How many believe that Galatians is a New Testament book? As a matter of fact, it's an epistle to the church, so therefore it's written to the church. You can't even say this in between. We could say the Gospels was, the ministry of Jesus was an Old Testament ministry leading up to the transition to New Testament. He fulfilled the old to bring in the new. Amen. But even in that, after he's raised from the dead, he still commissions them to go out and do what he told them to do. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. When he gave, these signs to follow them that believe, was after his resurrection. Hallelujah. Glory to God. All authority and power is given to me. Go into all the world and teach all nations, baptizing the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. So here we have the blessing of Abraham. And it says here that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles. Who in here is not a natural-born Jew? You're not a natural-born Jew. I was at the zoo yesterday. My calves are talking to me today. I got up yesterday. Listen to the Holy Ghost. I got up yesterday, and three times before I left my bedroom, I had an unction to get on my walking shoes. And I put on my top siders instead. because I didn't feel like getting my, getting down, getting my walking shoes. I keep them under my bed. I didn't feel like getting down, dragging them out, getting white socks, putting on white socks, putting the shoes on, doing all that stuff. I just didn't feel like bothering with it. My calves hurt so bad this morning. Oh, my. We walked, we walked from one end of the zoo to the other end of the zoo, then took the tram back up and then went walked down to see the alligators and stuff. We walked over, three and a half, almost 4 miles, in topsiders on, up and down hills and all that mess, and it's like, when the Holy Ghost says put on your walking shoes, put on your walking shoes. How do you know it's the Holy Ghost? Because he knew my calves were going to hurt this morning if I didn't, and I didn't, and they do. All right, so that's why the zoo came out, because I was... How many in this room are not a natural-born Jew? You're not Jewish in the natural, okay? Then, the blessing of Abraham, which we always believe, that people want to believe it's for the Jew, but he says here that it was for the Gentile, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles. If you're not a natural-born Jew, you're a Gentile. Now, when you get born again, you become a child of God, but I'm saying, in your natural lineage, you're Gentile. And the Bible says that Jesus paid the price, took it to the cross, that the blessing of Abraham would come on the Jew. Hallelujah. Y'all hear you going home. Glory to God. That it might come on the Jew, Gentiles, through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Now, there's two things here. There's the blessing of Abraham and the promise of the Spirit. They're not the same thing. Are you here? The promise of the Spirit and the blessing of Abraham are two different things. How do you know? Well, let's go over to Hebrews chapter 6. We're going to read back over there here in Hebrews. Glory to God. Chapter 6. Verse 13. For when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself. Now, God has made an oath. Everybody say, God made an oath. He made an oath to Abraham. Yes, he did. And swore by it. He couldn't lay his hand on the Bible and swear by it. He couldn't lay his hand on the throne and swear by it. He had to swear by himself. There's no greater entity. There's no greater being in all of the universe, all of creation, and beyond creation that exists than God himself. He is the supreme being. He is a divine personality. He is not a cosmic cloud of force. He is real. He has a personality. Amen. Glory to God. And it says here, he couldn't swear by anything else. He swore by himself. And this is what he said, saying, surely, talking to Abraham, blessing I will bless thee, and multiplying I will multiply thee. And verse 15 says, and so after he, Abraham, patiently endured, he obtained the promise. Glory to God. All right. Well, let's look here. Now, Weymouth translation says in verse 14, it says, assuredly, I will bless you and bless you and will increase you and increase you. Glory to God. Now, we look here into the word bless, and it comes from the Hebrew eulogio. And eulogio, okay? E-U-L-O-G-E-O, and eulogio, E-O, E-O. All right? Not E-O-R, but E-O. All right? All right, anyway. Eulogio. And it means to speak well of, to bless, to thank, invoke a benediction upon, to prosper. See, God wants to invoke a benediction or to prosper, to speak favorably of you. Hallelujah. God said, now listen to how he said it in Weymouth. I will bless you and bless you. And the Weymouth says, and increase you and increase you. I'll prosper you. I'll invoke benediction, blessing on you, and I'll increase you and increase you. This is the blessing of Abraham. I said, this is the blessing of Abraham. I'll say it again. This is the blessing of Abraham. Amen. Well, that was for the Jews. No, whoa. You can't tell me that's for the Jews when the Bible says that Christ bore the curse of the law that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles. Through Jesus Christ. The blessing is to come on us. I said the blessing is to come on us. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I find it, I'm not sure what I find. Sometimes people amaze me, particularly Christians. When God has offered something and God has paid a price to obtain something, and others by faith went and fulfilled God's promise. Remember, the Bible says that Abraham obtained it by patience, obtained that blessing. And then you got people come on, we just shouldn't have that. We should be humble. We know we shouldn't have anything. We shouldn't desire anything. We should only desire to go to heaven. Let's go back to original creation. God didn't make it rough down here. Only after the fall of man did the curse come on humanity. What was the threefold curse of man? Spiritual death, poverty, and sickness. Are you here? See, spiritual death causes body to be susceptible to death, made man carnal, mortal, death-doomed. Poverty, going to live by the sweat of your brow. The brow, the thorns and the thistles. There weren't any thorns and thistles until the fall. Creation got corrupted. Hello? And then man became susceptible to disease. Sickness, his body became perverted. See, sickness is a perversion of the healthy cells in the body. Spiritual death is the perversion of a human spirit's relationship with God. It perverts it into spiritual death, alienation from God's life. Doesn't mean you don't exist, just doesn't mean you're not in harmony with God. See, we've said this before. Death in the Bible never means cessation of existence. Death in the Bible means separation. Physical death is a separation of the human spirit from the physical body. Spiritual death is a separation of the human spirit from God. Hello. And so man fell. The spiritual death, sickness, and poverty is the curse that came on man. But original creation was not so. Man was blessed. Man lived of the fruit of what the earth provided without him having to do anything. It watered itself. Didn't even have to go out with a water hose. Didn't have to pray for rain. Hello? It watered itself. The dew was so heavy that there was enough water in the dew that that everything was watered. Because it basically lived in a greenhouse. The heavens were full of moisture. It wasn't until the flood that the heavens released all the waters and we had the flooding on the earth and they were separated and subsided, and but all that water didn't go back up into the atmosphere that you had to start having rain and so forth, and you had all these different things. This earth was like you didn't have polar caps. People talk about the lost city of Atlantis. It could have been on a land bridge that existed before the flood. That'll just mess up your theology. Anyway. Hello? Are you here? You're going home. Original creation was God's. You're talking about utopia. Forget the book Utopia, which is communism. All the communists use it. God created this so that man could just live in fellowship and harmony with him and be blessed and tend the earth and supposed to take authority over the one dude that was going to mess it all up. And he came down and messed it up and he listened to his wife and messed it all up. Adam was not on the backside fishing in the crystal lake, totally lived outside the blessings of God. God had created it to bless his humanity. We were to live of the blessings of God. The fall brought curse. The fall brought separation. The fall brought, driven out of the Garden of Eden, separated from the tree of life, where man couldn't take of that anymore. Man was not able to take of that. Man was created to have blessing. God put everything in the planet that man needed. Everything you will ever need, God has already made provision for on this earth, in this life, in this earth. He even gave us stuff just because we like to look at it. Diamonds and rubies and emeralds. Women, I didn't hear any woman say amen. And all of them were thinking, Pastor, be quiet. No, if you love her, you want to bless her, don't you? Amen. Hallelujah. He gave us stuff just because we like to look at it. He put all the minerals in the earth, all the things. You know, and anybody that can believe that, you know, there was some cosmic event that caused life to be created, that evolved into the intelligent beings that we are, and able to do things and create things and dig into the earth and mix things and make metals and make machines and all this kind of stuff, and it all came from a spark and an evolution, you got greater faith than I ever can dream of having. To have faith in that, it's either that or you're really, really, really not real bright. I'll go with the first one. Okay. So God says that, you know, in the original creation, God created us to be blessed. He didn't create us to be cursed. The curse was only a result of the fall. And from the moment that the fall took place, God was working to restore man back to the blessing. Are y'all here? You're going home. From the moment of the fall. How do you know? Well, Genesis 3:15. The seed of the woman shall bruise your heel, and you'll bruise his head. Prophesying the virgin birth there in Genesis 3:15. God was sending a redeemer. God was sending one to restore us. God had a plan. God, remember the Bible says when John the Baptist saw, behold, the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. God had already seen the fall. God had already made a plan for the fall. God already had a plan of redemption for the fall. Glory to God. And it was all to bring us back into the thing he originally created, was the blessing. He wants to bless. It's his nature. It's his heart. It's his desire. For me to, listen, think of the fact of me rejecting what he wants to do for me. It's kind of like that commercial. Have you seen that commercial? The dad shows up at the girl's birthday party and says, honey, here's another present. She said, no, thank you. Calls the guy into the office. The guy calls the guy into the office and says, we're going to give you a raise. I don't want it. And they're all, of course, everybody's looking at him like, you don't want the present? You don't want the raise, you know? Hello? They're turning down more. They're turning down, you know, getting blessed, you know. And it's almost offensive to the people who are doing it. I've had to work on. There are times people come to me and want to do something to me or give something to me, and they're in a worse place than I am. Hello? And you want to go, no, you don't have, no, don't, oh, I can't take that. You better take it. Several reasons on that front, but one is they want to bless you. Their love says, I want to bless you. You got to learn to receive. And God says, I want to bless you. How do you know? Because he told Abraham, I will bless you and bless you and increase you and increase you. I know this isn't a preacher running around the church sermon, but it can get there. We're laying the foundation, all right? So God wants to bless you, increase you, and increase you. Now, let's look at Genesis chapter 12. Before you do that, run to 3 John 2. I find John's prayer here enlightening. Can y'all say enlightening? Enlightening. Hallelujah. John's writing to the well-beloved Gaius, whom he loved in the truth. And then in the second verse he says this, beloved. These are terms of endearment. Or say terms of endearment, not the movie. Okay? I wish, now the word wish is really better translated pray. Okay? I pray above all things that you rid yourself of sin, that you grovel and humiliate yourself and humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, you sorry dog sinner. No, that's not what he said, is it? No. He says, beloved, I pray above all things that you may prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. Boy, he could have prayed a lot of things, couldn't he? I said he could have prayed a lot of things. But what did he pray? That you prosper and be in health. Above everything. He could have prayed, I pray you give all your goods to the poor. Come on now. He could have prayed, I pray that you spend 600 hours a day in prayer. Y'all hear you got home. any a litany of things that people would come up to you and say, you prosperity people, you're a bunch of name it, claim it, famous. Yeah, all you care about is getting rich. Well, John prayed that they would prosper and be in health even as their soul prospered. Now, I see in there, what I see in there, I see that as long as your heart is right toward God, you're pursuing God. That's soul prosperity. Your heart pants after him. As a deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee, as in a dry and thirsty land. Glory to God. See, I see that. I know that, you know, that my heart toward God, will be right as long as I'm pursuing him and desiring him and, you know, giving my all to him. But John said, I'll pray that you prosper and be in health above everything, even as your soul prospers. Amen. Well, what did 2 Corinthians chapter 9 say? See, here's where we mess up. Is there a selfish side to man? Yeah. But there's a good side to God. His good side is better than your selfish side. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, we'll start in verse 8. And God is able to make all grace, and if you study this chapter, it's talking about money, abound toward you. Study the chapter. Just don't get mad with me. Say, that's unmerited favor. No, it's money. This particular grace is finances. Study the chapter. Study 8, study 9. The grace, the bounty is talking about money, money, money. Money, 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 money. Money. You ain't heard that one in a while, have you? There's a reason. Anyway. And God's been able to make all grace abound toward you that what? Ye always. Listen to what we're saying. Here's God. Not sometime. Not part time. Not grovel through and somehow, some way you'll make it by some hook or crook. That you always, having all sufficiency and all things, isn't that what it says? May abound to every good work. May abound to every good work. Now understand this. I just want to do things for God. Then you're going to have the grace of blessing, a financial blessing. And you're going to have all sufficiency in all things, and that you may abound in all sufficiency in all things, that you may abound to every good work. You can't abound to every good work if you don't have all sufficiency in all things. Can I get an enthusiastic amen somewhere? Amen. Can I get at least one help me, Jesus? Now, if you get up and turn around and walk out like this, I know you're really upset with me. All right. As it is written, he is dispersed abroad. He's given to the poor. His righteousness remains forever. Now, he that ministers seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food, and multiply your seed sown, and increase the fruits of your righteousness. You give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. What are you supposed to do with the seed? You ain't supposed to put it on top of your muffin. You're supposed to plant it. You don't plant the seed, you don't get a harvest. Hello? That you always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. He ministers seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Now look at verse 11. Being enriched in everything. What? Now let's back up. Don't run ahead. We got the grace, the blessing of finances. He's giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, multiplies your seed sown, increases the fruits of your righteousness, and being enriched in everything. Amen? To all bountifulness. Again, bounty and bountifulness in these chapters, if you cannot study this with a true openness and not see it's talking about money. There's no way around it. Because that's what it's talking about. The whole premise is money. Everything they're talking about here is about money. Hello? And he said, being enriched in everything to all bountifulness. All bountifulness. What? Which causes through us thanksgiving to God. see God's bountifulness in your life and God's blessing in your life and God bringing seed to the sower and bread to the eater and blessing you and increasing the fruits of your righteousness and multiplying your seed sown causes you to have thanksgiving to God. Have you ever met someone who didn't? Of course, there's always some yo-yo brain out there. But the general principle here is that God will bless you in such a way that it'll bring thanksgiving in your heart toward God. When people get healed in the Bible, they went about giving glory to God. Are you here? I mean, somebody comes up and gives somebody 50 bucks, they say, "Woo, glory to God." It causes, something happens in the human heart when blessings come into our lives. And God is the blesser. I said, God is the blesser. It's the principle that He wants to have in our life, to bless you and increase you. Come on now. And so I'll be honest with you. We've been in the church because of misinterpretation and misapplication. I'm going to give you one of the biggest misapplications to the whole prosperity teaching was a bunch of people were getting rich off of it. Under the guise, you'll get blessed if you give big to me. They used what God wanted to do for people as a means to get great wealth unto themselves. Let me say this. They need to get it the same way you get it. You can't go around the people and tell them, I got a thousandfold anointing on me out there in the workplace. If you'll give to me, God will give you a thousandfold return tonight. You can't go tell people, I'm the higher anointing as a layperson. You got to give up to get blessed. You can't do it. Yes, the Bible says you don't muzzle the oxen that treadeth out the corn. The labor is worthy of his hire. But let's not take it to the extreme that, you know, that unless you break the bank of every church member in the church so you give a $40,000 card to the pastor, then you're not blessed. You'll never be blessed. Some preachers do it themselves. They tell the people they got to give to them, bless them. Now, I'm going to be real open with you. A couple years ago, we stopped doing Pastor Appreciation Day. People have asked me about it. Well, we had a situation where people were fighting, about to have fallout in the church over the blessing of the pastor. Well, it's not a real blessing when that happens, is it? And that's not a blessing. People fighting over it and saying, you know, what's happening with the money and who's handling the money and all this kind of stuff. I said, forget it. And we're not going to be the source of confusion and strife and envy in the church, you know, over somebody doing something because, you know, somebody was trying to do something for the pastor. You know, well, look, you know, we just said stop it. Now, maybe I'm wrong because I may be cutting off a revenue of blessing in your life, but I tell you what, I couldn't be a party to it. It just, it's like, you know, it's just not, it's not right to have people, we never want anybody doing something they feel they have to do, that they were manipulated into doing, that they, you know, by somebody coming up and going, yeah, you got to give, I'm going to go right on over here and get another one. These stewardship campaigns, where they bring in these companies from outside, and they come to the congregation. Let me tell you this. They won't come to your church unless you need $500,000 minimum. Why? Because they get the first 10%. Actually, I don't get the first 10%. They get the first $50,000. That's their minimum for coming in and setting up the campaign and doing all the stuff and flying in and getting your team together and getting them, teaching them how to go out and manipulate people. The teens go out and they get the church members to sit down with them at their dinner table and they say, okay, how much can you sacrificially give? And they put the screws on them. And people commit to things over 3 years. And many times they can't even commit to because there's so much pressure. You see, God doesn't want us to give grudgingly or necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. When they came to build the temple in Israel, they didn't come in and send out a team out there that was going to get, you know, the 10% of whatever came in. They get 10% of whatever comes in. But their minimum fee was 50 grand for 6 weeks' work and occasional follow-ups. It's a money-making deal. And what happens, we found out time and time again, churches lose members. because they can't fulfill the obligation they gave. They feel bad, so they just go somewhere else. Because they were under pressure. That's why we like to leave it open. If you want to give to this, fine. If you can give $2, if you can give $5, if you can't give anything, pray for us. We don't want you under pressure. We don't want you obligated. Don't want you to feel like you gotta, even when you can't. Because if it's not in your heart, and it doesn't come out of your heart, then you're giving grudgingly or out of necessity. And God loves the cheerful giver. Amen? So I know we haven't pressured people. You know? So, if you're wondering why we I think Larry was kind of heading up Pastor Appreciation. I went to him and said, stop it. I'm not going to be a party to this. I'm not God. You don't come to the altar to worship the pastor. Hello? Hello? And see, we misuse the prosperity message in many cases to enrich the preacher. Because a lot of preachers felt like for so long, you know, Lord, keep them humble, we'll keep them poor. That the church has made a hireling out of them and kept them bound and kept them down and kept them oppressed financially because they wanted control over the preacher in our denominational churches and so forth. That, you know, it's almost our day to get our come up and say, no. God's got to be our source too. Amen? God has to enrich me to all bountifulness. Now, if God speaks to you, fine. Amen? If somebody gets together and wants to do something, you know, I'll say this. If y'all want to do something, you can do something, but it's not going to be because I'm orchestrating it. And if there is an ounce of division, I don't want to be part of it. It has to be because people want to do something. Lord, we want to bless our pastor. Then it has to be because you want to, not because somebody's in your face going, we need for you to give it $75 more. We don't have enough to cover this. Church folk fighting over giving stuff to the pastor. There's something wrong about that. Hello? There's something wrong when you're told you got to get to a higher anointing so you can get blessed. And so you come up and take money out of your bank account you don't have and give it to the higher anointing and go home and you ain't got nothing in your bank account. And if you're giving to get the pressure off, that's your return anyway. Just, if you're on Facebook, send a love symbol across the screen. Say, I love him. I believe in blessing ministers. I believe in blessing, you know, pastors. I believe in giving to the poor. I believe in helping people. I believe in doing what God tells me to do. If I'm in a service and somebody giving $100,000 and I got 20 to give, then I'm giving 20 and not going to feel bad about it. There's days I'd like to be the one giving $100,000. I'd love to be the one doing it. Okay? I don't have it. And I'm not going to mortgage my house so I can. And I'm not going to take out of my children's mouth unless God specifically tells me to do something like that. I'll give within the means that I purpose in my heart or if he tells me to do something different. Amen. Are you here? And listen, God's got people who can give the 100,000. I would love to be one of them. Hello? But I'm not going to feel pressured to do what I can't do or don't have to do. Hello? And feel bad about it. How am I coming? Why? Because I'm supposed to have all sufficiency for all things that I may abound to every good work. So we got to get back to the right perspectives. Now let's we tie back in here. That was a little side trail over there. Okay. Because I want us to understand that the prosperity message is not about making preachers rich. Hello, I heard a preacher one say, "Oh brother, it's warm." I heard a preacher say one time. He said he was at a church in a meeting, a prosperity conference. And said he was sitting on the end of the seat. He didn't even preach that week. And people came by and put $25,000 in his pocket that week. If it doesn't work for the janitor who works at Walmart on the night shift, who slipped in and got into the last row of the back service, if it won't work for him, then it's not God. Why aren't people giving him money? No, because you've set it up so that you're the higher anointing. People have to give to get blessed by giving to you. Even if you didn't preach, they know who you are. I wonder how many of those people heard God say, go give it to that guy over there. If he doesn't have X number of dollars by this Friday, they're going to take his car away. He won't be able to get to work. He won't be able to feed his children. Oh, no, I've got to go give it to that preacher over there because he's the higher anointing of God, so I can get blessed. Don't you understand that God wants you to have all sufficiency and all that? God wants to be your blesser. And let me say this. Isaiah 1:19, if ye be willing and obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. You have to obey what God says, not be manipulated. A number of years ago, the first year we were here in Greensboro, a couple of guys were in the church, and one of them stayed in the church for a long time. And they went over to, there was a guy having a meeting down at the Coliseum. I won't use his name. But he came in, and they said, oh, Pastor Ed, you need to come down and see this meeting. I said, I don't have time to go there. I got too much going on. Jesse was a baby. We're still kind of getting our foothold and taking care of life, moving to a city, becoming a pastor, doing all things you need to do. I just have time to run to the Coliseum and hear this guy. All right? Oh, they were so excited. Last year he was here and it was so awesome. Da, 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 da. Okay, great. Praise the Lord. Be blessed. They come to church on that Sunday. It looked like somebody had stole the sugar off their Frosted Flakes. I'm telling you. Eeyore was singing lead in worship. No matter. I thought, wow. I said, what happened? I said, we went to that meeting. Yeah. I said, it was going to be great. Yeah. You know, we went last year. And they got ready to take up the offering last year. And he starts saying stuff and said, how? And turned around to his guy that travels with him all the time and said, I've never done like this before anywhere, have you? No, you've never done it like that before anywhere. And start doing things, gimmicky things, to get people to give. Guess what he did the second time they saw him? Exact same thing. Turned around to the guy and said, and started doing those things. And said, I've never done like this before anywhere, have I? Yeah, you've never done it like that before anywhere. But see, they were there the year before. What they count on is not enough people being there from the year before to know what they did it the year before and use the same gimmick to manipulate it into giving. Preachers, we got to be more, watch out for the gold, watch out for the glory, and watch out for the girls. The three G's of ministry destruction. The gold, the glory, and the girls. Brother Hagin preached that. You got to watch out for the money, how your attitude toward money. You got to watch out toward your attitude toward pride, getting lifted in pride about how great you are. When you get up and start leading worship, you start saying, how great I am, how great I am, you're in trouble. Hello? And then that last thing, you know, you got to watch out for the women. Because you ain't all that. They're attracted to the power. They're not attracted to you. I've seen pretty women go after ugly preachers. Hello? Are you here? Well, they're not after you. You're a dime a dozen. Your face, your mug, there's a whole lot better looking mugs out there. They're after the power. They're attracted to the power, the anointing. But you'll lose if you keep it up. Watch out for the money. Keep our attitude right about money. No way, no way, no way. This is my introduction. Oh, it's only 11:10 in Memphis. See, in knowing that God wants us blessed, and we start teaching that to people, ministers have to guard their hearts so they don't manipulate that to their own benefit. Don't you ever, if somebody comes to you and says, we want to bless the pastor, don't you give because they pressure you. And we're asking everybody to give at least $100. Okay. We're asking everybody. I know people in this church that can't give $100. If they gave $2, they would be giving what they more than they had. I mean, it would be a stretch for where they are right now. Now, if they keep giving and doing and, you know, working in the kingdom of God, they'll grow out of that. But I know people who $5 would be, I won't be able to pay my light bill this week. But, you know, I'm going to purposely ask God to bless me, okay? We just got to be careful about those things. And that, as a foundation, now we can back up a little bit and go, now, God wants you blessed. He wants you to have all sufficiency in all things, that you may abound to every good work. Now, where are we? Now you know there's a safety in the fact that God wants you to do things according to His plan, His way, so that you can be blessed according to how His plan is to bless you. And not be manipulated. We got people who will take all your tithe right out of the local church because they want it for what they're doing. Hello? They'll come in and they'll take up big offerings. Amen. They want, you know. I remember one time we were sitting in a situation with a TV station. And the guy was in there and he's sitting there banging everybody about how much they support the local TV station and all this kind of stuff. And I'm sitting there going, you know. And then somebody said, what about what so-and-so did up in with that television network that was a Christian network, and they sold it for $120 million to ABC. So how do we know that you're not going to do the same thing with the money we sow into you? He stops and goes, it's always about the money. Well, you've been banging on this for an hour about giving money. Now you're going to come back and act all whatever. Now, we'll let you know up front. It's not about me getting anything out of you. Hello? God wants you to be able to bound to every good work. God wants you to bless the church. God wants you to bless missions. God wants us to be able to feed people. God wants, listen, feed their spirits and feed their bodies. But we got to feed their spirits primarily. Wants us to be able to reach out. Now I'm gonna stop right here. We're gonna pick up next week. And on the end of that, I hadn't planned on doing this. We had somebody in church give us this with the understanding we would take up an offer to have offset some of the cost of this live streaming deal. Okay. It's $950 in equipment right there. Hello? Now, I think we should offset some of that with whatever you want to give. Okay? If you would give $10, I'm not asking you to reach out and get $950. Now, maybe you woke up this morning, you got an extra $950 in the bank, and God spoke to you and said, give it. Well, then, if God spoke to you, do it. But don't do it because, you know, I said it. Hello? Don't do it like this. You never know, Melanie. God might speak to you and tell you to pay for the whole thing. Next week, Melanie comes walking and going, I'm supposed to pay for the whole thing. No, I put that seed in her head. She's listening to my manipulation than she is God. No, whatever God tells you to do. Or if you don't have a number from God and you want a purpose to give, then you purpose to give. Not grudgingly out of necessity, because God loves a cheerful giver. It's what you want to do. And I'm not going to look at it and put a list of who's at church and go, yeah, they didn't get me. They only got me. It's not how you do it. That's not how you build the kingdom. That's not the blessing of God. Y'all, here you go home. All right. If you need an offering envelope, raise your hand. If you're going to give, you can just give and on the electronic means. And you can just label it. Streaming equipment. Camera. Let's say camera. And we thank you for joining us. We, Father, in the name of Jesus, if there be any lost or be any not baptized in the Holy Ghost, any sick, we speak to them. And Father, we speak life over them. We ask that you deal with their heart by the Spirit of God. You woo them and draw them and either lead them into a good church or give them an opportunity to communicate with us. You can call us at 336-832-0088. Our church number is 336-852-0088. Call us. We'll pray for you. We'll bless you in the name of Jesus. And we just call all of God's goodness and blessing on you in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. We're going to pray over these prayer cloths before we receive the offering. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, we speak life Even as the Word of God says that you wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, that you took aprons and handkerchiefs from him. And they were laid on the sick, and the evil spirits went out of them. The diseases went out of them. They were made every whit whole. We speak right now and lay hands on these cloths. That cancer goes. That the other diseases, whatever's not in the name in the book of law and what's not named in it, every disease. We thank you that you are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that heals us. And that your healing anointing is imparted into these cloths and taken and laid on the infirmed, on the bodies of those that are sick, and that the power of God drives it out of their bodies, makes them every whit whole from the top of their head to the soles of their feet, in Jesus' name. And everybody agreed that by saying, amen. Amen, 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 amen. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. All right, let's go ahead now. Receive that offering in Jesus' name. We speak blessing over you as you give towards offsetting the cost on this camera. Hallelujah. And again, your purpose. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fbc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.